Good afternoon, everyone. I am delighted to welcome you to the 2016 Friel Scanlon Clifford Scott Green Lecture. I'm going to keep my remarks brief, in part because I've been asked to by our speaker, and I certainly don't want to take his available time, but there are just a couple things I want to say about Bob Reinstein. Usually in these circumstances, I introduce the speaker to many in the audience who might not be familiar with the speaker. I suspect that almost everyone in this office, in this room, knows Bob Reinstein well. He has been a beloved member of this community for many, many years, and you have a summary of his bio in the program. But I want to say two things, one personal and one about this event. Not so long ago, I was reminded of the fact that when I was born, I wouldn't actually have been able to be in a classroom with many of the people in this room because I was born before the Brown decision, when people of color were not allowed necessarily to be educated with white people. And I am remarking at this time in my life about how far I've come and the position that I hold. And I want to publicly thank Bob Reinstein, who, as many of you know, is one of the reasons I'm here. He was my dean for 19 years. I served with him as the associate dean. And in those years, he gave me every experience that entitled me to throw my hat in the ring for this job in 2008. And Bob, publicly, I just want to thank you for that. Sitting next to Bob is his lovely wife, Tay Aspinwall. I should just say by my second personal point that I met Bob as the spouse of a college friend and roommate. So Tay and I went to Trinity College together in Hartford, Connecticut. And it was when she came to Philadelphia and she and Bob married that I was a guest in their home, and that's when our friendship started. So it feels that we've come really a long way to this day, and I'm really delighted to be able to call on you. But the last thing I want to say is that for any of you who know Bob Reinstein, and I want to thank all of my colleagues who are here today, you know that Bob bleeds cherry and white. That's a phrase that it's easy to say, but it isn't necessarily true. But this place being Temple University, has been a part of Bob's heart and life for many years. And in that context, he served with Clifford Scott Green when Cliff was a member of the Board of Trustees, and Bob cherished and loved Judge Green. So I am delighted that he is now the holder of the Clifford Scott Green Chair in Law to honor that association, and that when we asked if he would deliver this year's lecture, he graciously said yes. So I'm going to call Bob up here to talk to us about the Haitian Revolution. Thank you, Bob, for all that you have done and continue to do for Temple.
Thanks. Okay. Right. Thanks, Joanne. You know, it doesn't seem possible, Carol, that Cliff passed away in 2007. Just doesn't seem that long ago. It really seems like yesterday. But it's wonderful seeing you, a member of your family. I'm really delighted that so many of your members of your family and friends have come for this lecture. And also my colleagues, and I see even some of my students have come. So I'm very appreciative. I do want to say two words. One is, the way Joanne speaks about me, I speak about her. I think that, yes, I was dean for 19 years, and I think that the best thing I did was leave when I left, because it enabled Joanne Epps to become the new dean of Temple Law School, and she has been a spectacular dean. The last time I gave this talk was in 2009, the president of the university was here, and I said to her that she would be remembered for many things as president, but the most important thing would be that she appointed Joanne Epps as the dean of Temple Law School. So Joanne, thank you. Carol, thank you. And then there's Tay and our connection with Judge Green. Yes, Judge Green was my mentor. We were very close friends, and he was my mentor. He was my role model. He was one of the great lawyers in Philadelphia, one of the great judges in the history of the federal judiciary. I think what was really special about him was not just his sense of decency and honesty, but his fairness, his judicial temperament, and something I've said before, beneath all of that, his intolerance. He was intolerant of injustice. He was himself the victim of injustice. He served as a sergeant in World War II. And when he came back to Philadelphia, he came to Temple Law School. He graduated first in his class. He could not get a job at a white law firm. You know, instead, he went and helped form an elite law firm of African Americans, many of whom later became federal and state court judges. So Judge Green knew about injustice firsthand, and he spent his life fighting it. So he was, for me, the role model, and he was the person a lot of times when I needed advice, he was the person that I would go to, because he had exceptional wisdom. And he did something else which is relevant to this talk. He married Tay and me, okay? You know, after he conducted the ceremony, we were talking privately for a few seconds, and he said, Bob, you know, at a time like this, everybody's giving you advice about how to have a happy marriage. Do you mind if I make a suggestion? So it was Judge Green, right? So I said, of course. What's your suggestion? He said, my suggestion is listen to Tay, do what she says, and you will have a very happy marriage. Right? I tried. I have really tried. Once in a while, Tay would call Cliff up and say, Judge, I think Bob needs a refresher. But for this lecture, so I wrote this article on what you see, slavery and executive power, and its relationship to the Haitian Revolution. And I thought there were two ways of giving this lecture. One is telling a story. And the other is talking about legal doctrine. So I asked Tay, what do you think? And she said, what do I think? Tell the story, right? The legal doctrine is boring. The story is interesting. Okay. So following Judge Green's advice, I'm following Tay's direction, and I'll be telling a story. What I want to talk about are two things and their intersection with the Haitian Revolution. So one is the incredible amount of power that United States presidents have and have exercised. And you would never guess if you just read the Constitution that they have this kind of power. You would think that the center of power in the federal government, especially over foreign affairs, is in Congress. 14 of the 18 powers that Congress has relate to foreign affairs. And the presidency is just a skeleton. So how is it that the president has become primary in diplomacy in this country? And we've seen actions by the president over the last years which seem pretty remarkable. Okay? The United States giving funds, sometimes illegally, to foreign belligerents. The United States intervening in foreign civil wars. Presidents entering into executive agreements with other countries, not submitting to the Senate for ratification as treaties, just doing it on their own. Presidents engaging in secret military alliances with other countries. And perhaps most importantly, presidents assuming the war powers. That is, using military force abroad without congressional authorization or in reliance to very vaguely worded statutes. And we've even had presidents do that to make regime change. So how has this happened? Well, there's a conventional answer. In fact, we had a legal scholar here a few weeks ago who gave the conventional answer, which was, it wasn't that way at the beginning of the Republic. This is a process that grew incrementally over the course of US history. And as presidents acquired more power, their successors acquired that power, and it built up. And it really took off after World War II. This is the conventional explanation. And then there's another area I'm going to talk about, which is slavery in the early Republic. And there's a conventional wisdom there, too, about slavery and American foreign affairs. And that is, American foreign policy was pro-slavery. End sentence. Period. American foreign policy was pro-slavery. And if you were to ask somebody, give me an example of any foreign policy decision the United States made before the Civil War that was not pro-slavery, You might say, okay, Congress prohibited American participation in the international slave trade. That's it. Nobody can give another example. Okay. So we have two conventional wisdoms, and my talk today is they're both wrong. And they're both wrong, and the intersection of both of these is the Haitian Revolution. And what we're going to see is we're going to see presidents using all of the techniques that I just talked about, our first three presidents, using all of the techniques in response to the Haitian Revolution. And we're going to see the presidents using these techniques sometimes to advance a pro-slavery agenda, and sometimes, incredibly enough, doing it in an anti-slavery way. The Haitian Revolution was one of the remarkable events of the history of the Western Hemisphere. Like a lot of other remarkable events, it sort of disappeared from our history books. You know, how many people study it now in history classes? It was the first successful slave revolt in the Western Hemisphere, maybe the only one. It led to the creation of the second independent nation in the Western Hemisphere. To achieve this result, the Haitians defeated the invading armies of Great Britain, Spain, and France. The devastation of Haiti, which I think they never recovered from, is unbelievable. The number of Haitians killed in the period that I'm going to talk about, which is 1791 to 1808, the number killed in proportion to the population is 30 times greater than the deaths in the American Civil War. The population of Haiti was reduced from 500,000 to 250,000 during this period. So this was a remarkable event, and for most of it, the United States was not just a spectator, the United States was a participant. So let's start. So this was the island of Hispaniola in 1791, and on the left is Saint-Domingue, which was a French colony, which is now Haiti. On the right is Santo Domingo, which was a Spanish colony, which is now the Dominican Republic. Our focus is going to be on Saint-Domingue in 1791. You can see the distribution. There were about 40,000 whites living there. I list them there as colonial planters. It's not exactly accurate. A lot of them were planters and worked on the plantations. Others, they did have artisans, they did have other workers, but there were about 40,000 whites. There were about 30,000 free people of color, both blacks and mulattoes, and there were 450,000 black slaves. So the slaves outnumbered the whites by a 10-to-1 ratio. We think of Haiti now as a very poor country. Saint-Domingue was the richest colony in the Caribbean. It was the most wealthy colony, and it was the second largest trader with the United States, second to Great Britain. We had twice as much trade with Saint-Domingue as we did with metropolitan France. Okay, and it was more than any other country except for Great Britain. What was the trade? The plantations were producing and giving, selling to the United States mostly coffee, sugar, and molasses. Molasses was the big commodity. Why? Americans liked rum, and you need molasses for rum. Everything was sort of normal for the slave colony until August of 1791, when the slave uprising began. And as with most slave uprisings, it wasn't like 450,000 slaves immediately rose up. It was a group of slaves that rose in revolt and attacked the colonial regime. So the colonial regime is now under attack. The slave revolt is spreading. Where do they go for help? Well, you would think to France. They're a French colony. But this is 1791, right? 2 years after the French Revolution starts, there's starvation in France. There is tremendous political turmoil. taking place in France. They don't have a stable government. And the French are extremely worried about being invaded by European countries who don't quite appreciate what's looking like the overthrow of a monarchy in their midst. Plus, France is far away. Well, the United States is not far away. So the colonial regime goes to Philadelphia, to Washington, to get relief, to get help from the United States. When they arrive, they meet with the French ambassador. His name was Ternault. And Ternault agrees to approach the administration and ask for financial assistance to buy weapons, right? And to get weapons. When he gets to Philadelphia, he discovers Washington and Jefferson. Jefferson was Secretary of State. They're on their plantations, you know? It's hot, right, in Philadelphia in August and September. They're on their plantation. Only Hamilton's there. I'm really reluctant to say something negative about Hamilton because he's becoming a folk hero, right? you know? And I really like Hamilton generally, right? But what happens is the public reaction in the United States to the slave revolt verged from concern to hysteria. Several thousand of the whites in San Domingue fled to the United States and brought with them stories of the massacres by the rebellious slaves against their owners and the families of their owners. And these also took on an exaggerated quality to them. So there was a certain amount of concern. There was also hysteria, because one of the great fear of American slave owners from the beginning until the Civil War was a slave uprising. And you especially read this in the works of our then Secretary of State, Thomas Jefferson. The reaction of Washington, Jefferson, and Hamilton, the slave revolt had to be suppressed. Why Hamilton? Well, you know, Hamilton was the leader of the anti-slavery movement in New York, okay? But Hamilton was also a great believer in gradual emancipation, doing things through law and order. He was absolutely terrified of a slave revolt. So Hamilton's there, and Hamilton says, no problem, we'll give you $40,000. And the Secretary of the War is there, Henry Knox, and he says, no problem, we'll give you surplus military equipment. Well, how do they have the power to do this? Well, there were legal problems. Ternant's reaction was, so where's the $40,000 going to come from? The answer was that the United States had a Revolutionary War debt to France. France had, it's actually one of the reasons for the French Revolution. France had funded the American Revolution. And the debt in 1791 stood at $6 million. So Hamilton said, we'll make this an advance against the debt. Okay. Ternault said, I don't have authority to credit this money against the debt. Hamilton said, well, let's wait till Jefferson comes back. We'll talk to him, work this out. The other problem was, what statute authorized this? Well, the statute, Congress set up a statute for the repayment of the debt, right, over specific periods, and it had a clause that said there can be advance repayments if financially advantageous to the United States. Hamilton decided that the term financially advantageous meant we won't lose money. So as long as we can make sure we get it back, somehow it's financially advantageous, right? So taking it away out of the French debt would be a good idea. But there's this little problem that Ternault said, I don't have authority. So Jefferson quickly arrives. And Hamilton does this on his own. He doesn't consult Washington. He sends Washington a letter. This is what I did. And Washington sends back a letter saying, right on. Great move. Did just the right thing. I support you 100%. Tells Jefferson, get back to Washington. So Jefferson gets back to Washington. And he speaks to Ternault. And he said, look, these legal problems, you can't let these legal problems get in the way of doing the right thing. He said, when he used the phrase, when a person is being threatened by an assassin, don't get hung up with legal technicalities, right? And Jefferson then criticized Turnell and he said, why did you only ask for $40,000? You should ask for more. Okay. So Turnell does. Over that period, over the next almost 2 years, there are repeated requests for more money from the United States. The money is always forthcoming, and it's always forthcoming as an advance against the debt. So there's only one problem. Turnell sent messages to France and asked the National Assembly to approve this arrangement and to credit the advances against the debt. Twice they refused. And they refused because they thought they need the money for other purposes, for internal purposes. And they didn't trust the colonial regime. Right? The colonial regime was a bunch of aristocrats. Were they really supporting the French Revolutionary government? Right? And Turnell himself shared that concern and said to Jefferson, you might be giving money for this colonial regime, and what they may want to do is split off from France. Well, Jefferson decides, well, let me talk to the leaders of the colonial regime. So they come to Philadelphia and talk to Jefferson. Jefferson said, I've heard this rumor that you want to split off from France and go with Great Britain. And they said, oh, certainly not. That's slanderous, all right? Something Donald Trump would say, right? It's ridiculous. While they were saying this, there were officials from the colonial regime in London begging the British to invade Saint-Domingue, conquer Saint-Domingue and take it over, okay? Because at that time, all the British colonies had slavery, okay? But Jefferson was convinced, so he said, well, there's no real problem. Eventually, we'll get the approval from the French National Assembly. The other problem was the French merchants weren't so happy about this deal because the trade was going to take place on American ships, and they wanted the trade. So the legal problems aren't resolved. Jefferson is maneuvering all he can to give more and more support. At this point, Jefferson is apoplectic, all right? He's apoplectic because he's getting reports from Saint-Domingue that the slave revolt, which everybody, not everybody, but a lot of people assumed would be put down quickly as previous slave revolts had been put down quickly. It wasn't. It was growing. And it kept getting stronger until the point when Jefferson said, they've lost, or the slave revolt has won. Okay, this was a point when the advance against the debt was only about $300,000. Despite Jefferson saying that, he supported give them more money. If there's any hope in the world of suppressing this revolt, we should do so. Hamilton finally figures out we have got a major problem here. All this is being done in secret, by the way. We have a major problem, and he writes a letter to Washington saying we have a major potential embarrassment on our hands. And what provokes this is Prussia and Austria are now invading France. The French had suspended and then executed Louis XVI, which provoked an invasion by Prussia and Austria to restore the royal family. So Hamilton says, you know, George, if the royal family is restored, I don't see how the royal family is going to agree to credit this money against the debt. And we're talking about $700,000 now isn't much. It was a huge amount of money then. The gross domestic product of the United States was $5 to $6 million. Okay, we're talking about a gigantic amount of money. So Hamilton said, we are facing a very embarrassing situation. And the result of that was they decide more money over a monthly basis rather than in a lump sum. Right. So how do we get out of this? Well, get out of it because France declared war on Great Britain and Spain. The Washington administration took the position of neutrality, issued the neutrality proclamation. We're neutral in the wars. So what this meant was these special payments to France had to stop. You couldn't show preferential treatment to either country. So the payments stop. It's not a causal connection, but at the same time, the slave revolt is succeeding. The colonial regime basically collapses with the members of that regime escaping, mostly to the United States, and to warn the United States of the dangers of slave revolts. So at this point, Britain and Spain have a great idea, right? Because they are at war with France, okay? Joining Prussia and Austria. Let's take Saint-Domingue. So they invade. Spain by land, Britain by sea. They launch an invasion against Saint-Domingue, and the United States is now almost out of the picture, but what about the legality of the payments? And there, a very strange thing happens. The new French government sends Genet as its ambassador. And this is a long story about his agenda, but his agenda was to suck the United States into the war against France and on the side of Great Britain. So as a gift to show the good faith of France, he brings a letter from the National Assembly, we're crediting all of your payments against the debt. Right? So the legal issue is resolved by luck, not by good planning. For the next 5 years, the United States is not involved with Saint-Domingue, except trade is still going back and forth, despite the wars. And now we have a war of Britain and France versus Britain and Spain versus France and what I call the insurgents. They're still rebels because Saint-Domingue is still a colony of France. The leader of the rebellion is Toussaint Louverture, one of the more remarkable characters in history. And Toussaint decides to fight with the French. This is after conducting a rebellion against the French. Why? Because the French National Assembly passed a decree eliminating slavery in all the colonies. Right? Remember, liberty, equality, fraternity? Right? So the French National Assembly eliminates slavery. Britain still maintains slavery in its colonies. They have 300 slaves at this point in Jamaica. Right? So Toussaint fights with the French. It's more accurate to say they fought with him because the French army was very small. The real fighting was done by the Haitians, and I'll call them Haitians from now on, even though we still don't have the country of Haiti. Spain withdraws in 1795 because it withdrew from the fight against France. They had been defeated, so they withdrew. Britain suffers one of its most catastrophic defeats in its military history. 20,000 British soldiers are killed by the Haitians, and the British invasion is repelled. And one of the historians of the British military, said that if you want to look at the early phase of the fight against France by the First Coalition and ask why Britain fought so poorly, the answer is Saint-Domingue. The invasion of Saint-Domingue was crazy. It diverted incredible resources that should have been used in Europe fighting against France. And to put the icing on the cake, they lose. This is 1793 to 98, and the United States is out. Well, the United States is about to come back in. John Adams is president. As you know, he was Washington's vice president. He becomes the second president. He's president this time. And a war starts with France. It's called the Quasi-War. Why the Quasi-War? It's not a total war. It's a limited war. It starts, the relationship between the United States and France started deteriorating in 1795. It got to the point where French warships and privateers on one day seized 200 American merchant ships in the Caribbean. Okay? They just seized them and sold them. They wanted to make a point. The United States responded, Congress responded, authorizing the Navy to attack French privateers. Okay, you know, you all know what privateers are, right? These are, right? These are people who have their own boats, and they're operating on their own, but with the blessing of the French government. French warships, and any armed merchant ships, which is all merchant ships, because this time in the Caribbean, everybody is armed, okay? Because everybody's fighting everybody else. Congress also imposes an embargo on U.S. trade with France and all of its colonies. So it authorizes the Navy to seize French ships and American ships, any American ships heading towards any French port. Okay. We then get, in 1799, what is called, what Jefferson dubbed the Toussaint Clause. Toussaint Louverture made a gesture. He sent a letter and a spokesperson, an emissary, to Washington to see Adams, and said to Adams, let's work this out. We can help you in your war against France. Toussaint Louverture at the time, his title was General of the French Armed Forces in Saint-Domingue, right? And he's proposing a sort of alliance with the United States against France. Why? Because Toussaint wants independence, right? And he wants France out. He wants France to lose. Adams actually thinks it's a good idea, and the first step is Congress amends the embargo to say that there can be trade with Saint-Domingue if it can be done safely. Okay. The biggest dissenter from all of this is Jefferson. Jefferson is now calling the Haitians cannibals. You heard me right. Cannibals, right? The cannibals of the Western Hemisphere. He's predicting that Toussaint has won, it's irreversible, that this will lead to the end of slavery on the other Caribbean islands, and it will then lead to a slave revolt in the United States. So he's adamantly against any kind of gesture or any kind of deal with Toussaint. If only he had known what was going to come. The British withdraw. And they do so peacefully because Toussaint lets them go, actually gives them amnesty. The British army is virtually non-existent at this point. As I said, I think they lost 20,000 soldiers on Saint-Domingue. They withdraw. But the Royal Navy is controlling the seas. So the Adams administration thinks we can't do a deal with Toussaint by ourselves. We need Britain on board. This leads to a lengthy negotiation between the United States and Great Britain, which is memorialized in an agreement between the two, which sets the parameters for an agreement with Toussaint, with the Haitians. Both of them are secret agreements. They're not shared with Congress or the public. The first one is signed by every member of the cabinet, binding the United States. The second one is so secret it was withheld from certain members of the cabinet for fear of leaks. The second is a military alliance between the United States, Great Britain, and Toussaint and the Haitians. So if you're thinking, when I said before, if you're thinking the United States always intervened on the side of slavery, think about this. The United States into a military alliance with the leader of a slave revolt who wants independence and to create an independent black nation in the Caribbean. Basically, what the alliance said was this, that two ports that Toussaint controlled would be open to American commerce, that Toussaint agreed that his forces would prevent any French ship from using any port under his control, which was practically every port in Saint-Domingue. This is the general of the French armed forces in Haiti, right? United States and British ships, on the other hand, are welcome. And by no French ship, he's not talking about just armed ships, no French ship. Even ships in distress will not be allowed to find safe harbor in one of the ports. And he's going to eliminate the privateers eliminate Haiti or Saint-Domingue as a base for attacks on United States commerce. The U.S. and Britain agree that he can have a navy, right? But it has to, each ship has to be approved by the American consul. His name was Edward Stevens. And in terms of his trade with other countries, each vessel had to be approved by Stevens, right? So that is the agreement. Originally, Adams told members of his cabinet that if he did have an agreement like this, it would be taken to the Senate for ratification. Of course it's not. Of course not. It's kept secret. The United States wants to keep it secret for a number of reasons, one of which is if it gets public, this quasi-war against France can become a total war against France. Toussaint wants to keep it secret for the same reason. He's afraid of a fellow named Napoleon. Like, who isn't? Okay? And this is, of course, treason. So he also wants to keep it secret. The British interest in all of this is they're at war with France, and they see this as a step also of bringing the United States into their war against France. The agreements are withheld from Congress, from the public, even from some cabinet members. Don't know the contents of the agreements. And Toussaint and all of this is being treated as the head of government. The agreements talk about, right, the government in Saint-Domingue. So I put down here, we had a quasi-war, a quasi-treaty, and a quasi-recognition, okay? Next. Okay, so now we have secret agreements, executive agreements that don't go to the Senate and that are kept secret by presidents, and regime change. Okay, and by the way, through this whole period, the American consul in Haiti is telling the president and the secretary of state, Toussaint will declare independence. Adams is actually ambivalent about this. The members of his cabinet, most of whom got their directions from Hamilton, who was out of office, but they went to Hamilton and said, what do you think about this? Should the United States support Haitian independence? And Hamilton's answer was, no and yes. We cannot have our fingerprints on this. That would be a foreign policy disaster. But we should give the word to Toussaint that if he does declare independence, of course, there will be increased trade with the United States. We will recognize his government. We'll have diplomatic relations. But nothing can be in writing. And this becomes the policy of the United States. Toussaint gets this word, but he doesn't declare independence. And what happens is a civil war breaks out within Saint-Domingue between Toussaint and one of his generals, André Rigaud. Toussaint controls the northern part of Saint-Domingue, Rigaud the southern part, and Toussaint begs the United States for military help against Rigaud. Now, why would the United States help Toussaint? Because Toussaint is pro-US. He wants independence. Rigaud is pro-French, right? So the first thing that the Navy does is it destroys Rigaud's Navy. Rigaud had his own navy. It destroys it. The second thing is the United States institutes a blockade of Saint-Domingue. Then the strategic position of Rigaud is at Jacmel. The United States frigates go to Jacmel. They impose a blockade, which is an act of war. And it's also the blockade is against, what are we doing? The blockade is against neutral shipping, which I'll talk about very briefly. Rigaud holds out against an invasion by Toussaint from the north and the American Navy. So what does the American Navy do? We bombard and destroy Toussaint's forts, at which point Jacmel surrenders, Toussaint flees to another place, and this is continually repeated. the United States Navy had authority only to seize French ships and American ships heading towards French ports, which this latter gave rise to a case that a lot of you study in constitutional law, where we seized an American ship going out of Jeremy, out of Jekmel, and the Supreme Court held it illegal, unconstitutional. But how do you stop neutral ships from going through, right? So the US Navy makes a deal with Toussaint, which is, we'll seize the French ships and the American ships. Your Navy will seize the neutral ships. We will have nothing to do with this. All of this is way beyond the authority given by Congress. It's the first time the United States has actually used military force against a foreign country. It's not only not authorized by Congress, it's kept secret from Congress. Toussaint is victorious. He issues a constitution making him governor for life of Saint-Domingue. And he thanks Commander Perry, who's the head of the American forces. He gives him $10,000 worth of coffee, right? Well, you know, what Perry did was all illegal, right? So Perry gets court-martialed by the Navy. He gets court-martialed by the Navy for accepting the gift of coffee from Toussaint. And his defense was, the gift was not for me personally, it was for the United States Navy in gratitude for our military actions at Jekmel. On that basis, he gets acquitted, okay? And he points to the orders from the Secretary of the Navy. The orders were basically, I can't tell you what to do, but do anything you have to defeat Rigaud. We're now into 1800 and 1801. Napoleon now seizes power. He becomes the dictator, the first consul, the dictator of France. And he enters into a peace treaty with the United States to stop the quasi-war. Unfortunately for John Adams, the word of it got back too late for the election. He probably would have been reelected if the word had gotten back in time, but it didn't. Napoleon also enters into a treaty of peace with Great Britain, and Thomas Jefferson is elected president. And now we have a situation with peace prevailing everywhere. Saint-Domingue is no longer a strategic asset of the United States. So Jefferson tells Toussaint of a new policy. It is neutrality. The alliance that Adams had, which they find out about when the peace treaty is signed, that alliance is gone. We'll continue trade with you, but that's all. And then Jefferson calls in the French, and he proposes something which, for Jefferson, is remarkable. He says, look, you've lost. Okay. Give Haiti independence. And it will be independent as a protectorate of the United States, Great Britain, and France. In other words, we'll have an independent nation that is contained by the Western powers, so we don't have to worry about the spread of the slave revolt. Napoleon turns him down flat because Napoleon has another idea. Invade Saint-Domingue, right? The British are now out of, the Royal Navy is now out of the way. So he prepares an invasion. Napoleon had suffered one defeat in his military history. It was in Egypt. And one of the reasons he lost 13,000 soldiers, the whole army, one of the reasons for it was he didn't have secure supply lines. So he had to get secure supplies. So who does he go to? He sends his ambassador to Jefferson and saying, your idea of an independent Haiti is out of the question. In fact, my boss, Napoleon, is going to invade. And we would like your support. Okay? We need guaranteed supplies for the invasion. At which point Jefferson says, no problem. We will supply your army and starve Toussaint. Okay? This is like, there's the Jekyll and Hyde, Jefferson. The Hyde has just come out. So an army of 50,000, this is the largest sea invasion since the French Armada. An army of 50,000 troops from the Army of the Nile, This is the army that had fought and defeated the first coalition, invades Haiti. It's headed by Napoleon's brother-in-law, Leclerc. It's a disaster. The French lose, there are 50,000 troops are killed, right? By a combination of disease, the fighting by the Haitians, and the fact that they're not getting any supplies from the United States or from Great Britain. They got the same promise from Great Britain. Jefferson turns around, and Jefferson tells the merchants, it's okay for you to trade with Toussaint. Do not trade with the French. And when the French go to get a loan from the Bank of the United States, the answer is no. When they go to get a loan from the United States government, Madison says, don't even ask. Right? The United States is now again supporting Toussaint. Okay? Why? And what's going on here? I have here a vicious war. This is, the French still almost win because they engage in genocide. They decide to kill any Haitian they see, whether a military person or a civilian. And they almost win the war, and then Napoleon makes a terrible mistake. He issues a decree rescinding the National Assembly's decree abolishing slavery. And suddenly the Haitians are faced with, if we lose this war, we're back into slavery. It's not just a question of independence anymore. The fighting is vicious. And American merchants, our role in this is we continue to supply Toussaint. The trade is coffee and molasses coming to the United States, guns coming to Haiti for Toussaint. And the French armies are defeated and they surrender to Great Britain. And by the way, Napoleon, when he sent the army out, in his goodbye message to the army, he said, you don't have to worry about supplies. Jefferson has promised to supply the army and to starve Toussaint. So why did Jefferson change Louisiana? Okay. What happens is partly through British intelligence and just partly through American intelligence on the continent, what is discovered was there was a secret treaty between Spain and France in which Spain ceded Louisiana territory to France. In 1801, at the same time, there was a peace treaty with the United States. And Napoleon's plans was for a military empire in the West, the recreation of the military empire before the Seven Years' War. And there was a symbiotic relationship here between Saint-Domingue and Louisiana. Saint-Domingue would provide the base for the French Navy and for the invading armies. Louisiana would provide supplies to Saint-Domingue to restore Saint-Domingue to its position as the wealthiest colony in the Caribbean and a tremendous asset for France. When Jefferson finds out about this, he turns 180 degrees. Instead of starving Toussaint, we're starving the French. Okay? This is Jefferson as Machiavelli. And they also learn from intelligence. Napoleon, he didn't like periods of peace. You know, it was like, got to do something. So invading Saint-Domingue is one thing. And it's time to go back to war against Great Britain. So he needs the money, right? Madison writes several times, we have two possibilities here. And the real fear, by the way, is the French taking possession of New Orleans. Because half of American foreign trade goes through New Orleans. Okay. So Jefferson, on Madison's urging, sends emissaries led by James Monroe to France to buy New Orleans from France. And he says, we have two potential trump cards. One is Saint-Domingue. The French are losing, right? With our support, the Haitians are defeating the French army. The other French card is Napoleon, if he's going to go to war with Britain, he really needs money. Well, to everybody's surprise, Napoleon agrees not only to sell New Orleans, but the whole Louisiana territory for $15 million. It's like a bargain basement sale. to get it through the treaty under Jefferson's constitutional principles, this treaty is totally unconstitutional. But it's a great deal. All of his cabinet says they figure out ways to say it's constitutional. Jefferson goes along, and we get Louisiana. So what happens is, one of the biggest ironies of history, the black Haitians make possible the greatest achievement of Thomas Jefferson's administration. It's why his face is on Mount Rushmore. Okay? And Jefferson makes possible the Haitian Declaration of Independence by supporting the Haitians in the war against France. You can see now the population is down to 250,000. So then what happens to American foreign policy towards Haiti? Jefferson refuses to recognize Haiti as an independent nation. He says there is no Haiti. He orders every member of his cabinet never to use the word Haiti. It is still Saint-Domingue, a colony of France. But, he says, we will continue to trade with Haiti, and the trade is still, I wouldn't say flourishing, but it's still pretty substantial. Napoleon, who has plans, as soon as he defeats the British, he's going to launch another invasion of Saint-Domingue. He hasn't given up. Napoleon starts complaining and threatening Jefferson, stop the trade. At this point, for the first time in this whole narrative, Congress intervenes. And oddly enough, it intervenes in a bill introduced by a Quaker from Pennsylvania who's afraid of a new war with France. And it's a bill that stops all trade with Haiti. And the purpose of this bill is to isolate Haiti and to give in to the demands of Napoleon. Well, the Southern members of Jefferson's Republican Party couldn't have asked for more. And they join on. And if you really want to get nauseated, you should read the legislative history of this, right? Where people say, I deny that Haiti is a nation. The idea that black people can form a nation is heresy, right? Others said we would burn in hell if we had relations with a black nation, okay? So the embargo is passed and trade with Haiti is cut off. And since the United States is the senior trading partner with Haiti, on top of all the other devastation to Haiti, this drives Haiti into economic ruin. During the debate, one of the Federalists stood up and said, have these Haitians no rights? The answer was no. The answer was no. They have no rights. Henry Adams, who was the historian of the Jefferson administration, called this, I think he's exaggerating because there were probably worse laws, he called it the most disgraceful law ever passed by Congress. So a little bit of a sequel. France recognized Haitian independence in 1825. It did so by the Haitians had to agree to an indemnity to pay reparations to the planters for the destructions of their plantations. And in order to get recognition from France, Haiti agreed to do that. Britain then followed very quickly and recognized Haiti. The United States refused. And this was the administration, I'm sorry to say, of John Quincy Adams, refusing to recognize Haiti. Yes, yes, John Quincy Adams, the great anti-slavery fighter, okay? Because by 1825, things had changed. There was a pro-slavery foreign policy in the United States. And as against anything else, slavery wins. The United States finally recognizes Haiti in 1862. After the Confederate States secede, they can't stop it. Lincoln asked Congress and said, you know, it's time that we do this. Why not? And the U.S. recognizes Haiti. So if we look and just summarize at what I would call the arsenal of executive power, I don't want to have to go through each one of these, but every single one of them was used by the United States government in connection with the Haitian Revolution. The president made foreign policy, not Congress. We intervened in civil wars. We used the U.S. military without congressional authorization. The treaty powers expanded. We even had a secret military alliance. So when one looks at where did presidents get this power, was it that early presidents respected their constitutional limits and it happened incrementally? No. It's just we're ignoring an incident in history in the early republic where early presidents thought that this was something they could do, and they did, even though under conventional legal doctrine, what they were doing, most of what they were doing, was unconstitutional. And then there's the question of slavery in the early republic. And the answer in the early republic was when there were forces of geopolitics and international trade that were really important to the United States, that actually trumped slavery as a determinant of American policy. If those forces weren't present, or if they were antagonistic, right, to Haiti, then the United States followed a pro-slavery policy. So we can learn a lot from looking at the United States' reaction to the Haitian Revolution and constitutional development, both in the growth of executive power and in the role slavery played in the early republic before it got so entrenched as a force in the United States where it was non-negotiable. Okay. So thanks, everybody, for listening to this talk. I appreciate you coming. Thank you.